Hello everyone, myself Rohini Kallur. Welcome to another lecture video on the subject ARM microcontroller and embedded systems with a subject code of 17EC62. So the course content whatever we'll be covering in today's lecture are, we'll see the example of a washing machine application specific embedded system, and we'll also see automatic domain specific examples of an embedded system. In the previous video lecture, the content covered was the non-operational attributes of an embedded system, which tells us about the portability, evolvability, time to prototype, time to market, per unit cost, and then per unit volume. After seeing all these contents of what is a application specific or domain specific embedded system, what all it should be having, what should be the characteristics, what should be its operational characteristics, not non-operational characteristics, and so on, we'll now have a look at what is a application specific embedded system with two examples. So the learning objectives are, today this lecture will illustrate the domain and application specific aspect of the embedded system with an example, and it also will come to know about the presence of an embedded systems in an automotive industry. We'll talk about the high speed control units and low speed electronic units. We'll talk about the controller area network, that is CAN protocol, LIN protocol, and MOST protocol that are used in the automotive applications, and we'll know about the semiconductor chip providers, tools and platform providers, and the solution providers for the automotive embedded applications. So in the introduction part, we have the embedded systems. We know that they are application and domain specific, and they are specifically built for certain applications in a certain domains like consumer electronics, telecom, automotive, industrial, and so on. In some of this we will be discussing in this today's lecture. So we'll look at the first one, that is washing machine application specific embedded system. We know washing machine, how it operates and what are its inputs, what are its outputs, what will be the input devices, and how it will be connected. So we know that a washing machine is a typical example of an embedded system which provides extensive support in home automation. So we know that an embedded system will be having sensors, actuators, control unit, application specific user interfaces like keyboards, display units, etc., and so on. So we'll see all of these incorporated into a single washing machine and how they'll be operated. So the actuator part in the washing machine will be a motorized agitator. It has a tumble tub, and we'll be having a water drawing pump and the inlet valve to control the flow of water into the unit. And the sensor part will be the water temperature sensor and water level sensor. Control part will be microprocessor or a controller based board with interfaces to the sensor and actuators. The sensor data that is fed back to the control unit, and the control unit generates the necessary actuator outputs. The control unit, what we have in a washing machine, also provides connectivity to user interfaces like keypad for setting the washing machine washing time, selecting the type of material to be washed like light, medium, heavy duty, and so on. And we'll be having one more called as user feedback, that is reflected through the display unit and LEDs that is connected to the control board. This is the image of a washing machine. Okay, it's a functional block diagram of a washing machine. So it has, we can see that the washing machine actually comes with two models. One is called top loading and the front loading. Here the top loading washing machine is being discussed. In top loading machines, the agitator of the washing machine twists back and forth and pulls the cloth down to the bottom. And on reaching the bottom of the tub, the clothes work their way back up to the top of the tub, where the agitator grabs them again and repeats the mechanism. Whereas in front loading machines, the clothes are tumbled and plunged into the water over and over again. So this is the first phase of washing. So what happens in the second phase is the water is pumped out of the tub, and the inner tub uses centrifugal force to wring out more water from the clothes by spinning at several hundred rotations per meter, that is RPM. This is called the spin phase of the washing machine. If you look into the keyboard panel of the washing machine, you can see that there are three buttons, that is wash, spin, and then rinse. Wash, spin, and then rinse. So we can see that these buttons configure the washing stages, and the from the figure we can see that the inner tub of the washing machine contains a number of holes, and during the spin cycle the inner tub spins and forces the water out through these holes to the stationary outer tub, from which it is drained off through the outlet pipe. So it is to be noted in the design of the washing machine that the design of the washing machine vary from manufacturer to manufacturer, but a general principle lying in the working of the washing machine remains the same. The basic control on the washing machine consists of a timer, a cycle selector, and has a cycle selector, a water temperature sensor, and it also has a load size selector and a start button. So what we have in the next section is we have a integrated control panel, which consists of a microprocessor, controller, and then will be operating IO interfaces in the integrated control panel. The input interface will be using a wash, spin, and rinse. This will be used for the selection. And we have also seen in the IO interfacing, that is keypad section, that there are selectors for light, medium, heavy duty, and washing time setting. All this can be done by using a push buttons, which will may enable that particular selection, and they'll be working according to that. The output interface consists of LED and LCD displays, the status indication LEDs, etc., that are connected to the IO bus of the controller. It is to be noted that this interface varies from manufacturer to manufacturer. The other type of IO interfaces that are invisible to the end user are different kinds of sensor interfaces, namely water temperature sensor, water level sensor, and actuator interfaces such as motor control for the agitator, tub movement, and then inlet water control, etc. After having a look at a washing machine, we'll now look at what is an automotive domain specific example of an embedded system. The major application domains of the embedded system are consumer, industrial, automotive, telecom, and consumer electronics. So here we talk about the automotive industry, which where the embedded system takes a greater part. So in the initial one, this is an image of a car which tells us where all we can have an embedded system coming into picture. Though it may be an instrumentation, though it is an engine control, if it is a fan control, your fuel injection, your headlamp control, ABS, wiper, power windows, and so on. Wherever we have all this, there are on a whole, this tells us that there are 15 embedded systems which are incorporated on the top. Then when we go into the depth, we will be seeing that there are multiple IO interfaces, multiple protocols, multiple communication interfaces, which will be interfacing with respect to this to generate an output. So the inner working of the automobile system, whatever we have, are we will automotive embedded systems are the one where the electronics take control over the mechanical systems. So here we have the presence of automotive embedded systems in a vehicle, which varies from simple mirror to a wiper to a ABS, or it may be a airbag system and so on. So automotive embedded systems are normally built around a microcontroller or a DSP or a hybrid of the two, and are generally called as electronic control unit. The automotive embedded systems are normally built around the microcontrollers, DSPs, or hybrid of the two. So this is called as an electronic control unit. Then there are various types of electronic control units used in an automotive industry that can be broadly classified into two. One is called high-speed embedded control units, that is HECU, and low-speed embedded control unit, that is LECU. HECU is nothing but a high-speed electronic control unit that are deployed in critical control units requiring faster response. They include fuel injection, anti-lock brake systems, engine control, electronic throttle, steering control, transmission control unit, and a central control unit. Low-speed electronic controls does not require that speed, that are deployed in applications where the response is not that time critical. So they are built around low-cost microprocessor or controller or a digital signal processors. The audio controllers, the passenger and the driver door locks, door glass controls, wiper control, mirror control, seat control systems, headlamp and tail lamp, sunroof control, etc. are the low-speed electronic control units. Automotive communication buses. Automotive communication buses means the automotive applications use serial buses for communication, which greatly reduces the amount of writing required inside a wiring required inside a vehicle. So the the communication buses, whatever are there, they are CAN protocol or CAN bus, LIN bus, MOST bus. CAN is a controller area network, and the CAN bus was originally proposed by Robert Bosch. It supports a medium speed up to 125 kbps and high speed up to 1 mbps of data transfer. So CAN is an event-driven protocol interface with support for error handling in the data transmission. It is generally employed in safety systems like airbag and the powertrain systems like engine control, ABS, and navigation systems like GPS. And it is also used in the protocol format, and it uses a better networking interface in the automotive. Then the next one is a LIN protocol or a LIN bus. LIN is local interconnect network. LIN bus is a single master, multiple slave. Multiple slave means up to 16 independent slave nodes we can interface using this LIN bus. LIN is a low speed single wire communication interface which supports for data rate up to 20 kbps and is used for sensor and actuator interfacing. The LIN bus follows the master communication triggering technique to eliminate the possible bus arbitration problem that can occur by the simultaneous talking of different slave nodes connected to the single interface. LIN bus is actually employed in applications like mirror control, fan control, seat position controls, window control, position controls of the seats, where the response time is not time critical. Then coming to the last bus, which is used in a automotive industry, are MOST bus. MOST is media oriented system transport. The media oriented system transport is targeted for automotive audio and video equipment interfacing, used primarily in European cars. The MOST bus is a multimedia fiber optic point-to-point network implemented in a star, ring or daisy-chained topology over optical fiber cables. The most bus specifications include the physical layer as well as the application layer. It also has a network layer and a MAC layer. Most bus is an optical fiber cable connected between the electrical optical converter, that is EOC, and optical electrical converter, that is OEC, which would translate the data into the optical cable of most bus. Then next, we'll see what are the companies that have this automotive embedded market. So we have here the key players, which is divided into silicon providers. Then it is divided into solution providers, tools and platform providers. Silicon providers, we have different companies which are operating upon the different embedded systems. So silicon providers are responsible for providing the necessary chips which are used to control application of the development. The chip may be a standard product like microcontroller or a DSP, ADC or DAC. So this is actually an application specific integrated chip. So we have different companies coming into picture here. One is called Analog Devices. This is a provider of world class digital signal processing chips. It has a precision analog microcontrollers, programmable inclinometers, accelerometers, LED drivers and so on. All these are used for automotive signal processing applications. And then we have one more company called as Xilinx, which is a supplier of high performance FPGA, CPLD and automotive specific IP cores for GPS navigation systems, driver information systems, distance control, collision avoidance and rear seat entertainment, adaptive cruise control, voice recognition and so on. Then we have another company called as Atmel, which is a supplier of a cost-effective high-density flash controllers and memories. Atmel provides a series of high-performance microcontrollers, namely ARM, AVR, 80C951, a wide range of application-specific standard products, that is ASSP, for the chassis, body, and security and safety, as well as car infotainment and application automotive networking product for CAN, LIN and FlexRay, which are supplied by Atmel. Then we have the another company called as Maxim. This is the supplier of world-class analog and digital mixed mode signal products. It has RF components for all kinds of automotive solutions. Then we have NXP Semiconductor, which is a supplier of 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit flash microcontrollers and so on. So there are n number of companies which provide one or the other components to the automotive industry. Then coming to the tools and platform providers, we have tools and platform providers are the manufacturers and suppliers of various kinds of development tools and real-time embedded operating systems for developing and debugging different control unit related applications. Tools fall under two categories, that is embedded software application development tools and embedded hardware application development tools. So here we have a company called as ENEA, which is a developer of the OAC real-time operating system. This operating system supports both CPU and DSP, and it has also been specially developed to support multi-core and fault-tolerant system development. Then we have one more company called as MathWorks. It is a world's leading developer and a supplier of technical software. It offers a wide range of tools, consultancy and training for numeric computation, visualization, modeling and simulation across many different industries. So MATLAB is a product of a MathWork. It is a high level programming language and an environment for technical computation and numerical analysis. Together, MATLAB and Simulink, Stateflow and real-time workshop provide a top quality tools for data analysis. Then the last category in the tools are the solution providers. Solution providers will tell us about, they supply OEM and a complete solution for an automobile application, making use of the chips, platforms and different development tools. So the major players in this particular area are Bosch, Denso, Infosys and so on. Bosch is providing a complete automotive solution ranging from body electronics, diesel engine control, gasoline engine control, powertrain systems, safety systems, in-car navigation systems and so on. Denso Automotive is another company which is a original equipment manufacturer and a solution provider for engine management, climate control, body electronics, driving control and safety. And it also provides us about the embedded infotainment and communications. Infosys Technologies is a solution provider for automotive embedded hardware and software. Infosys provides competitive edge and integrating technology change through a cost-effective solutions. So, the summary of the lecture is the embedded systems designed for a particular application for a specific domain can be replaced with another embedded system on another for another platform with a different domain. Consumer, industrial, automobile and telecom are the major application areas, and telecom and automotive industry are the two segments holding a big market share in the embedded system. So for this particular lecture, we have referred to the textbook called as Introduction to Embedded Systems by Shibu KV, and we have referred from the PPTs from the www.slideshare.net. We'll meet in the next video. Till then, thank you.